you use the you word weird, right? And I wanted to enter in this new field here, synthetic biology. Let me say here, I still think you are a sexy futurist, but this topic makes me real afraid. It's really, really, really different. In your latest book, the Genesis Machine, you describe this world where we could have, multi-parent mother or family. And I'm trying to correlate those things with the very conservative societies that we are still living with. It seems to me that it's kind of a time bomb, right? It's like these things are going to block sometime. How do you see this all new technology, all these new possibilities facing this old world? People trying to deny that. Is there a way to pause this evolution or to make this mix maybe better? How do you see this happening?
Right. So let's maybe take a step back, because if people are not familiar with synthetic biology or bioengineering, they may be saying, what the hell is he talking about? So basically, bioengineering combines biology with engineering and a couple of other disciplines like computer science, artificial intelligence, even classic design. And the idea is to engineer or re-engineer life, to design it or redesign it to have new and improved purposes. So within the umbrella of bioengineering are tools and technologies like CRISPR, which is that system that you can use to edit genes, and also synthetic biology, which is where researchers design code on computers. I mean, biological code is really just ACTG. Computer code is 1 and 0. Biology is that, but letters and 2 more, so ACTG. And in the right combinations, you can, redesign or design new things. So there are some researchers that have already designed a minimum viable genome. It's a living organism, and its parents were not other organisms. Its parents were computers, okay? So why would we do this?
It's a good question. Yes, exactly.
And a lot of people get very upset that, we are going against God and we shouldn't be changing life. That's why should we do that? And I think that there are some good reasons for us to think about it. We have some serious climate change issues. You are well aware of that in the global South and in Brazil in particular. So here's something to think about. Brazil has a lot of abandoned mines. Mines are dark places. You can't live in them. It's just kind of like a space you can't really use. Well, what if sugarcane, which is grown in Brazil, and it's like hard to grow and it's hard to harvest and it, requires all this stuff. What if we could re-engineer it so that it could be grown in a mine? And maybe you could get fiber optic lights to get light down into the mine. And now you're able to grow something in a way that's better for the environment, that makes use of a space that you've already got. I think of coffee. Brazilian coffee is magnificent. And it's going to be hard for you to grow in the years to come, because coffee, especially Brazilian coffee, requires very specific types of weather and humidity. So again, is there a way for us to engineer that coffee plant so that it can adapt and grow given the climate change? And people who are climate change activists get very mad at me when I say this, because to them, this is like giving everybody an excuse to keep cutting down the rainforest or to keep polluting or whatever. It's not an excuse to keep doing that. I mean, we should also figure out ways to stop, but there are huge macroeconomic forces. So, it's impossible to just stop doing those things overnight. It would devastate many economies. So this is another way to mitigate. There's some other really interesting things. You guys eat a lot of meat in Brazil, like a lot.
Yes. Maybe less than Argentina, but yes.
Less than Argentina, but yeah. A lot. Okay.
A lot.
So if population trends continue, you're going to need more meat. And it's harder and harder. Again, like there are variables outside of your control that have to do with, again, climate change and availability and all these things. If you take from a biopsy a tiny bit of meat from muscle tissue, let's say from a cow or a pig, you can grow that in a factory and it will turn into edible meat. And it will be the exact same molecular structure as the meat that would have come from the chicken or the cow or whatever. But it requires very few resources that you can control for it. You don't need antibiotics. So again, farmers get really mad when I talk about this. But the reality is someday this is going to be a much better way to produce protein that we all want to eat. And you can already do this today. So there's all these different applications once we start thinking about biology as being programmable. Now, to your original question about multi-parent children. So yeah, that's also possible. Right now, in Japan, scientists started with some skin cells from one person and created a sperm and an egg. And they were, not from a person, it was from a mouse, but they were successfully able to create something called an induced pluripotent stem cell, which is basically a special type of stem cell that you could turn into anything. So you could turn it into a kidney. If you need a kidney transplant, imagine growing your own kidney and not having to wait for an organ donor. But yeah, at some point, this will be a way, probably an alternative to create a new child. Let's say I'm a single person. This means you don't have to get a donor egg or donor sperm. You know, it's also possible, like, I don't know, this sounds crazy, but let's say that there's two people who are very nice, they're very smart, but they're not what we would call classically attractive. What if they could get Rodrigo Santorino? Do you know who he is?
Yeah, famous guy here.
Oh my God, that guy. That guy is beautiful. Let's say like you just got a little bit of him mixed in, and now you've got a child who's brilliant and lovely and also really attractive because of those Brazilian genes, right? And so he's gorgeous. So there's all kinds of possibilities. Now, this also means that all of this technology can be used for terrible purposes. Yes. The last thing that we want is a country or a cult. Let's say somebody starts a cult and tries to create superhumans by experimenting with genetic engineering. We don't want that. Let's say a country or a company or somebody tries to introduce a new strain of sugarcane, and let's say it grows really well in an abandoned mine, but it turns into a weed or something out in the real world and it winds up killing the rest of the sugarcane crop. There's all kinds of possibilities here. My point is that this is inevitable. So this technology already exists. It's already being used. And so it's a little bit farther off in the future than AI, but we need to start talking about it right now because we have to thoughtfully regulate it and we have to think through the negative, like the potential catastrophic next order outcomes of this. And we have to make sure that it gets used so that everybody prospers.